we have a real climate justice movement that has emerged in the past few years and is moving towards our vision of a healthy and just world, and not waiting or being held back by, you know, whatever the big green groups say. And so those groups are faced with a choice of whether or not they're going to join with that climate justice movement and get behind that, or whether they're going to continue their strategies. And I think the Sierra Club is trying to make that choice of crossing that divide and joining the climate movement. They still have a ways to go, like with what's happening in Illinois right now. And the fracking issue in Southern Illinois, it's looking like EDF, the Environmental Defense Fund, and the Sierra Club are backing a sellout bill that is going to give a green light to fracking there under the guise that it's being regulated. And the grassroots groups in Illinois are fighting that. So there's a little bit of a division there, and we'll see how that plays out. You know, I think we need to keep pressuring those groups. And keep moving forward, and not be held back by them. You know, to look at the big green groups and say, you know, like, we're going to do what needs to be done. Hopefully, you're with us. If not, we're going to keep moving forward. Yeah. Yeah, in the back. Yeah.
I'm moving up
and
not. I know all the reasons you wouldn't go into politics, but I think your voice is really critical. Out of Utah, maybe in New York.
It's up to us here.
The question was, have I considered going into politics? I'd rather not. I mean, not as a candidate anyway. I think I'm probably perhaps too divisive to be a candidate. But I certainly intend on continuing to be involved in politics. You know, you saw the campaign that we ran there. I kind of enjoyed that. Maybe not that last scene with all the glass of wine, but, you know, I intend to do more things like that and get involved in more political strategy because I do think our movement needs to start building political power. And political power for a movement means the willingness and ability to take candidates out of office. And we've never done that as a movement. You know, so that's something I hope to be more involved with moving forward. Yeah, on the side.
When I was young, there was a young boy, there was a major march on Washington which helped to bring down the Vietnam War, which was important. Is there anything linking all the groups to do a major march on Washington, much like the march on Washington against the war in Vietnam?
The question was, is there anything linking all the groups to do a huge Vietnam-style march on Washington? Not that I know of, not yet anyway. You know, that may or may not be successful. You know, I mean, I think as we have some successes as social movements over the long term, those in power learn from that just as much as we do, and they learn ways to make those same tactics not effective in the future. I think we can learn from the principles of what kind of things are needed in terms of a social movement creating change, but in terms of like copying tactics, they may or may not be successful. And right now, I think we're in a position where we don't necessarily need everybody to be on the same page in the movement. That's something I hear a lot of activists talking about like, how do we get everybody doing the same thing? How do we get everybody on the same page? But we don't really know what that page should be. I mean, lots of people say that they have the answer, but nobody's ever solved the climate crisis before. Nobody's ever overthrown corporate power to the degree that we need to right now. And, you know, so nobody knows exactly what's going to work. And I think we need a lot of creativity, a lot of people trying new things and seeing what gets momentum a little bit. You know, when Cesar Chavez talked about his movement being well-organized, he said, when we're well-organized, it doesn't mean that everybody's doing the same thing. It means that everybody is pushing on this wall in their own spots. And everybody's pushing on this wall, and when someone finds a weak point on that wall that gives a little bit, then we all get behind them and keep pushing and open that weak spot up into a gap and then open it up so more people can flow through and break down that wall. And for him, that's what being well-organized meant. Not that everybody's doing the same thing, but everybody is taking the actions that that seem appropriate to them, knowing that they're part of a bigger, powerful movement, knowing that they're not an isolated individual, but that they have this movement behind them and that they can act powerfully in that way.
I'm not out there. The movie ended with you going to prison.
Yeah.
And in our society among us, like, that's the last, worstest thing in the whole world. And yet, I think we need to be not afraid of going to prison. And so how did you do your time? And how did you find doing your time? And how can you inspire us to think that doing time is simply not the worst thing? I think one of the underlying issues in doing time is racism.
Yeah, and I'm
looking around here.
I found that it was not nearly as bad as I expected. You know, I found that prison was hard at times. It was tedious at times. It was certainly inconvenient, but it was not horrible by any means. It was something that I could handle. You know, one of the consequences of mass incarceration. And the fact that we have an order of magnitude more people in prison now than we did a generation ago, is that our prisons are filled with normal people. You know, that drastic increase in the number of people we have in prison didn't happen by some major change in human nature. It happened because the private prison industry lobbied for changes in our laws that allow us to lock up normal people for much longer periods. You know, and like the folks that were featured in the film, like David Harris and John Shuchard, who had spent time in prison, they spent it in prison a long time ago when most of the people that were in our prison system committed a crime that most of our society found to be inappropriate. And that's not the situation at all anymore. You know, like in the federal system, you know, less than 10% of people across all security levels in the federal system are there for any kind of violent crime. And that's about the percentage of our population that was locked up a generation ago. That, like, that less than 10% is the kind of population that we would have had in prison a generation ago. And that other 90%+ is all normal people that a generation ago wasn't the kind of people that we would have put in prison at all. You know, I found prison to be a learning experience in a lot of ways. You know, one, it was a very reflective kind of environment. Actually, the lowest stress environment I've ever been in. You know, part of that is that, like, there's very little that you can control, so there's not much to worry about. And, you know, a lot of my day was taken up with, like, walking the track and reading and stuff like that, exercising. So it was this very reflective environment. And it was also a growth experience for me because it was 2 years that I spent living with really one of the most oppressed populations in our entire country, the prison population. That are certainly oppressed in their current situation, and most of them are there because they were disempowered in some way before they got locked up. And so it was kind of an eye-opener to personally get to know a lot of those people who are in that situation.
How were the guards?
The question was, how are the guards? I said on the radio the other day that while I was locked up, I probably met 50 people who just really shouldn't be in society, who we should keep separated. And of those 50, I'd say 5 were inmates, and the rest were all guards. Almost every single guard in the federal system comes straight out of the military. Hardly any of them have ever had, like, a civilian job. And most of them are traumatized by war in some way and psychologically damaged. And, you know, I think whether it's conscious or not, you know, our government is making the decision that it's cheaper to give our military veterans a job in the prison system than it would be to treat their psychological disorders. You know, so on some way I have sympathy for them, but they're also some of the most disturbed people I've ever met. And no.
What's your next move? Where do you intend to push?
Well, as it said there at the end, my next move is I'm going to be going to Harvard Divinity School in the fall. And I see that as an extension of my previous activism, not as a change in direction. You know, I plan on continuing to be an activist and continuing to be a climate activist, but also recognizing that climate change is an issue that's intricately linked with so many other social justice issues. And so I think my activism will be a little broader moving forward and addressing some of these other issues. Certainly I'm going to be involved in criminal justice reform issues moving forward. Yeah.
Can you speak to, the whole film really was about what movements have been successful and civil disobedience and grassroots, you know, civil disobedience actions being the things certainly in my lifetime that have been the most successful. And I just wanted you to speak more to that. I really feel like you're a visionary and an incredibly important voice, and I'm wondering, I mean, I'm hoping that you haven't changed that belief system that the whole film talks about.
No, definitely not. You know, I do think that civil disobedience is an important part of any social movement of people that are outside of the traditional power structure. And it's a part of what needs to be a diverse movement that tries to put pressure on that system in a lot of different ways. You know, really, I don't think it was talked about in the film, but that semester before I disrupted that auction, I was taking a course in U.S. social movement history. And so I was studying social movements, and that's one of the things that helped get me in that position of thinking about civil disobedience and knowing that was necessary. It's one of the things that helped commit me to that path, was understanding how change has happened historically in our country. And yet I'd also say that at that time I didn't fully understand the power of civil disobedience. One of the things that I didn't understand going into this that I've learned going through the process is that in addition to being like a tactic for putting pressure on those in power, civil disobedience is also really a powerful education tool. That it's really effective at getting through to people, especially those who don't necessarily agree with your views. And that's been an interesting experience being in Utah, in really one of the most conservative states of the country, having a lot of people who are on the exact opposite end of the political spectrum from me, as we normally think about it anyway, who would say things like, well, I don't really agree with you on a lot of that climate stuff, but I really like the way you're going about things. And they would really be interested in my story and in the personal side of my story, and in the part of it about an individual trying to hold the government accountable. That really appealed to people. And I think there's just this natural human desire that when we see someone else putting themselves in harm's way, we want to understand that, and that seems to get through to people, even when they have this kind of intellectual barrier where they're like, oh, climate change, that's a liberal issue, I'm not going to listen to that. And like, no matter what facts and figures you throw at them, they're not going to hear it because they've got that very intellectual barrier. But when it's this personal story, then they're interested in that, and that opens them up to be educated in a different way. And so for me, that's been one of the most powerful parts of the experience.
And thank you very much for the image of the finger and the fist. That was a beautiful way of describing it that I'll never forget.
Thank you.
Can you just say how you were on parole before you were convicted?
I wasn't on parole. I was on pretrial. And I was on personal reconnaissance with no bail or anything. So there were some restrictions, but not a lot. All the way in the back.
Are you restricted in any way since your release? What you can say and where you can say it?
No, not in what I can say. I have to get all my travel pre-approved ahead of time by my probation officer. And I can't get arrested. That's kind of the big thing at this point. Yeah, so for 3 years, I can't get arrested.
There are other people who can be.
Yeah, good. Yeah, you guys are going to have to fill in for a few years. You know, one of the things that some people don't realize is one of the changes with the war on drugs is that it really changed the way that probation works, in that if people get busted for a violation of their parole, or their probation rather, whether it's, you know, like missing a meeting with a probation officer or failing a drug test or, you know, getting arrested for trespassing at a protest or something like that, you go back to prison for a while, like 6 months, a year, year and a half, and then when you get out of prison, the probation restarts. And that's the new thing. That it used to be that if you violate a probation, you go back and do some time, and then you're out. Or at least, you know, when your period of probation would have expired, that's the end. And now they're able to keep people in the system for life by continually restarting that probation every time they make a mistake. And I met a lot of people when I was locked up that were in that situation where they would keep getting rolled back into prison. And their sentence, you know, would have been up years ago, you know, but for relatively minor things, they were being sent back to prison a year at a time and then getting a new 3 or 5 year period of probation. Yeah.
There's some controversy here locally in the anti-frack movement as to whether we should pursue better regulations and try to have it regulated out of existence or at least minimized, or whether we should just make it a crime with something called public law number one, which would criminalize fracking, make it a felony with serious fines. How do you feel about that? Should fracking be made a crime, or should we try to regulate it?
You know, the argument behind regulation is that, like, that there would be a way to do it safely. And I've never seen any indication that that's true. And even if it was true on like a technical level, in order for it to be true in practice, we would have to have a government that put the well-being of the people first, a government that was more concerned about protecting people than it was about protecting corporate profits. And you know, that's my opposition to a lot of things like that. That, you know, like advocates of nuclear power make the same kind of argument that, you know, there are new modern ways to do it that could be done properly, which may or may not be true. And if we had a democracy, that could be an option. But as long as we have corporate personhood in this country, I'm never willing to go down that road.